Welcome to Tennis Channel Live. It is a new year. We have new graphics and we have this glorious brand new studio. Welcome to the show alongside Hall of Famers Lindsay Davenport and Jim Courier. Steve Weissman, so happy to be with you here, kicking off 2021 in Tennis Channel's brand new studio. Happy New Year
Happy
to both
new
of
year.
You all. Linz, how's it going?
It's going well. This is amazing. Can you imagine when this network started all those years ago? I first worked here in 2009. I can't believe this is real.
This is home.
The
place is incredible. I mean, I showed up on time for our meeting. I didn't realize if you're not 5 minutes early, you're late with this crew. You guys are so early, ready to go. We've been here for hours, and we're excited to talk some tennis.
Listen, I've been waiting years for this, too. We heard about it. It was rumors. It's here. We cannot wait to show you all that we can do for you in this new studio. 18 years in the making. So much has gone into this. Hard work, sweat, equity. But here's what's coming up on the show today. A lot to get to. Tennis Channel actually debuted a few months before Roger Federer won his first major title. When can we expect him to return? Plus, a new year, high expectations. What will we see from Serena, Rafa, all the big superstars? And Madison Keys, our first guest, joins us, telling us what she has been up to. One of the best things to come out of 2020, Hall of Famer Andy Roddick joined the Tennis Channel family. And he looked great in the old studio. It looks even better, Andy, in our new studio. Great to see you. Happy New Year, Andy. You're like 12,000 feet tall. How you doing?
I'm just trying to figure out why the long face here. I said to all of you earlier, and I really meant it, this is a special moment. I'd like to celebrate the new studio by calling in via Skype. And it's a tough thing. I mean, I'll miss the old studio, even though I'd never been in it.
You'll miss the old studio that you used to tune in by Skype as well. That's good news. Andy, you know,
correct.
You, like many players, have kept yourself busy with some social media stuff in the offseason. We got one we just want to get a comment on, kind of a who wore it best type scenario. I think we know who wore it best. I guess the question is, who wore it first? How did this happen with you and your daughter?
Yeah, I mean, as you would think, I woke up in the morning and I was just like, you know, it kind of feels like an Elsa day, and her wanting to be like daddy, put hers on straight afterwards. But the things we do for our children, and especially my little girl, she's a big Frozen fan. This was her birthday, and she said, "Daddy, you're gonna wear a dress," and I said, "Yes, I am going to wear a dress."
Well, if there's ever a Frozen 3, I mean, Roddick's got to be the guy, right?
He's right in there.
He's auditioning pretty well.
Yeah.
Looks good.
Might just take care of the chest hair next time. I don't know.
there was a little too much taco meat. Sorry about that.
All right, let's get into it. I mean, it's just fantastic to have tennis once again in 2021. Got to salute the tennis tours, the stakeholders, everybody for giving us opportunities, the players to play and be out there. Jim, how'd they get it done?
Yeah, well let's say thank you first and foremost. But it's taken flexibility, it's taken creativity, and it's taking priorities also. The majors taking the priorities, the ATP, WTA being generous with their schedules to allow tournaments like the Australian Open to shift because they've had to, because the local government has forced them to, and that they've all scrambled and tried to find spaces for their tournaments and offer these opportunities for the players who have also been very adaptive here as we've moved into this new normal, which we'll hopefully move out of by the end of this year.
Yeah, and one of the things from where I sit is there was a lot of uncertainty, maybe some players not happy with having to go into the bubble in New York City. There's a little bit of controversy around that. It seems like people have kind of lived and learned a little bit with everything we're going through. You hear a lot less of that. The quarantine is going to be pretty intense. Kudos to Craig Tiley, because it was always going to be difficult. Australia, rightly so, has been very, very strict. And has been one of the kind of thought leaders to really, really mitigate this terrible pandemic we're going through. Craig Talley was always going to have to thread the needle between the safety protocols in Australia while trying to put on a huge worldwide tennis event. And so, but if there's one person you kind of want at the helm to kind of figure that out, it is Craig Talley. And, you know, some of the other tournaments have maybe benefited and gotten in some nice schedule spots because of it as well.
Yeah, exactly. I think everybody's learned after 2020 that if we're going to have tournaments and we want this international sport to go on, there has to be flexibility really from everybody, from the players, from the tournaments, from everybody involved. There may be fans, there might not be fans. There's quarantine of a certain length. At a different country, it's a different length. Players have to learn all these protocols and kind of figure out where they're going, what that country expects from them, what they can expect when they get there. They just want to play, though. At this stage, we saw players last year, top players, play a handful of tournaments. We saw some play 6, 7 maybe at the most. They want to get back to their sport, and we're going to do everything we can, hopefully, in this year to see them more often.